needed to be accomplished on the farm, and that if they weren't accomplished, you know, everything had to be done my way, when I wanted it, on my time schedule, and I had no flexibility, no compassion. It was like, James, and then all the ugly stuff comes out of my mouth, you lazy, blah, blah, blah. I don't even go into all of it, but, you know, up one side, down the other. And I got to the point where I said, why am I doing this? And I said it out loud. Why am I doing this? Why am I saying these things? And it was going back and forth between all of us, and Kayla screaming in the middle of it. And it was just a horrendous day. And it took two-thirds of the day to get to the point where I said, why am I doing this? And from that point, we got into dialogue. Kayla's still screaming. We're in dialogue. We're, you know, I'm trying to cope with Kayla's demand for attention in the midst of us trying to work things through. And, I mean, we only got any kind of clarity just by going into dialogue.
Is it possible that there was no way that you were going to go into dialogue until you were already satiated?
Yeah, oh yeah, I mean, two-thirds of the morning, I was just feasted on blame, and you're wrong, and I'm right, and I'm superior, and I know what needs to be done here, and you know, I feasted on it for two-thirds until it wasn't doing it. I mean, I guess I got enough to say I can get off it now. Yeah.
Yeah. You can only eat so much, right? And you're like, oh.
And I feasted.
And our challenge was that I was feasting on the same thing.
You have infinite.
In what way?
I was in the blame, you know. I'll do it when I damn well please, you know. I'm going to get around to it. I just don't want to do it today, you know. You always make me wrong. And so I was the one, you know, I was doing the same thing. I was feeding that same entity.
So what do you do when you're challenged with a gremlin and you can pretty well say that's what's going on? It's someone else's gremlin.
What do you do?
Chop his head off.
Does it work? What are the ways to kill an entity? What are the ways to kill a vampire? Remember in Men in Black, you know, his head goes, he's like, and he just stands there and his other head goes, and his head's back again, you know? What do you do?
Well, I didn't do it well. That's what I did.
Yeah, when you're the victim of an entity.
I mean, I just now realized just now that that's what happened yesterday.
In what way?
Well, I ended up just moving to my side of the bed and being mad and sad and then telling myself it didn't really matter. But I feel like it was the privilege of being a gremlin.
So the entity shows up. What happened? Hungry,
uh-huh.
Right? Only one thought in mind, food.
Okay.
Looking for food. Where's food? Ah, right in my own bed. Look at
so
this.
The victim totally,
but what was the mechanism? What was the feeding process? What's the hook? How did he get you? What's the way in? What happened?
Was the reason to do what I asked him to do? You know, I came wounded and hurt and sad and you know, and then just become silent and didn't talk
to that.
Oh. But that's my question. What do you do when you can see that someone else is grimly?
Well, let's talk about it.
Well, my question, I mean, it's sort of a training ground. I'm wondering how can you, the question for me would be, what am I doing to attract so many gremlins? Why is it that gremlins are what I'm attracting? And so in that, I mean, I have the same experience sometimes, and I think the question for me is, why am I attracting gremlins, and how am I fed by this? And where is it that I'm fed by what's going on? Because I'm obviously doing it. It's happening, and things are moving around me. And so my unconscious purpose is serving me. What's going on? And the minute I find victim, and I do inevitably, I'm thinking, okay, there it is. There it is. I get to feel this. And I created gremlin all the way around me. so that I'm irresponsible. I didn't do it. Look how bad they're being. And so I can do that. I mean, I've had the same conversation. Look how bad those people, he is wicked, look at that. And so I can, my gremlin is sitting back, because my gremlin is all powerful. My gremlin sits back and says, you know, and the minute I want to, I do it. They get bad enough, and I say, oh, these fuckers need taken out. And I do it. I do it inevitably, but I set it up. And that's what I'm saying. I don't think you can be too ruthless.
Well, you set up breakfast, lunch, and dinner.
I set it up so that I'm saving the world.
Yeah.
The queen of hearts.
I better take them out, or Jean's going to get hurt. Uh-huh. Or I'll take them out because you guys don't need to experience this. Let me do it. Mm. And I'll do it.
Go right for the neck.
And it doesn't even matter. So that's why I don't think we can be too ruthless, because if it's happening around us, we're creating it.
Well, it seems to me, too, that for me, I mean, a couple of things have come up. That when I have been able to convince myself that I'm the victim, that the gremlin's teeth are already just absolutely as sharp. I mean, the gremlin's there already. It's not like I'm getting ready to become that entity. That entity has already taken over. I don't catch it then.
Have they fed already.
I don't catch it until it starts to become where I really feel like I'm plowing people down, and then I go, oh.
Till you're
But I've already been feeding for who knows how long. I mean, because I haven't consciously chosen to know how long. And that's the other thing that I was thinking when Kelly was talking about it, that, you know, it's really scary. I mean, I see how masterful that entity is, in that I think I used to spend a lot more time feeding with my sword out. Now I feed through, and it was bloodier to the outside observer. Mm-hmm. So that entity, that gremlin, has gotten more refined, and I don't feed as much that way. I stop myself more quickly that way, but I feed other ways, through becoming the victim, or, I mean, you know, that's another thing for me to look at and pay attention to. How many other ways am I feeding it? Because it seems to me that it's still definitely getting fed, and I'm not feeding it the way that I have in the past with as much. So...
Well, and that is a working example of why, of how that gremlin and all gremlins are committed to principle only.
Yeah.
The activity doesn't matter. It will change. It's like a mutating virus. I mean, it will mutate mm-hmm. and change and become whatever's necessary, because it's only committed to principle. Activity doesn't matter.
And what's the principle?
Destruction or death, or, you know, destroying, I would say. Deconstructing things around you.
Mm-hmm. For the benefit of the food that it derives.
Right. But that principle is all that matters. And so that's what I meant, but I don't think we can be too ruthless, because it will mutate. The minute you identify it, it will mutate. So it's not about identifying and capturing it and killing it. It's about learning to live with it. Learning to live in relationship to it. And knowing that you don't have to necessarily recognize it all the time. You have to be aware of what principles it's committed to, and know that you will never hunt down every activity it creates.
Mm-hmm.
The thing is, because I spent the last couple of months hunting it down, you know, here and there, and what I know is it's different today than it was yesterday, because I found it yesterday. And so it's not about finding it. It's about knowing what principles it's committed to and committing to different principles.
And are you making, you're saying that that's the same as the unconscious purpose?
It is the unconscious purpose. The principles it's committed to is the unconscious purpose. It is my gremlin is strongly committed to destroying other people for the illusion of safety. Strongly committed to that. I mean, infinitely committed to it. And so much so that I would create safety in this room by promising to destroy whatever would hurt us. And it's learned to use it very effectively in the theater. Very much control the environment so actors can come into the place and feel safe. And then with my sword, strongly destroy anything that comes into that space that isn't the illusion of safety. And that, I mean, that's fine. I mean, it works beautifully. But it is like, it works beautifully from the place of committed to a stronger principle. And it only works in that environment because it's an understood principle. and
can
everyone
you have
else.
More than one unconscious purpose?
Yeah, I said there's four or five, six usually.
So we have them all?
Everybody has their own particular flavors. Yeah. Each entity has its own characteristics.
Now, I'm starting to wonder if bipolar exists.
What's bipolar?
The manic depressive illness, psychiatric diagnosis of...
Oh.
I mean, I'm starting to question whether or not it exists because...
Yeah.
Because my experience is that, I mean, I felt bipolar in the last couple of months. It's like, I'm there, now I'm here.
That's this.
I know. Yeah. I know, and I've literally felt it. And I mean, it's crazy, because in a day, I mean, I really feel like I'm going crazy. Because I'll be in the car, and Mary will be over there, and everything will be going fine. And I'm not kidding. It's like 2 seconds later, it's like this raging head is over there. And I look in the mirror, and I know this is a raging head. It's like we've been driving down, and things were wonderful, and we turned into, like, corn people. It's just like... And we'll just go at it. I mean,
I know.
I'm like, oh. And I'll say something like, okay, I'll roll the windows down and say, okay, let them out. And I've been calling it my crazy self. I'm trying to, like, okay, my crazy self's coming up.
But they won't leave until after they've fed.
Right.
Okay.
It's just, oh.
Your original question was, how do you deal with someone else's grandma? Right?
Yeah, well, let's talk about this for a second, okay? Because, like, how did you and Mary find each other?
How did we find each other originally?
In looking at the situation from the point of view of the entity, what's the value of the two of you being together?
I mean, it fits like a glove.
Yeah.
It fits like a perfect glove. Because, I wish Mary were here so she could speak her part of it, but my part of it is that, I mean, I grew up in the same dynamic. Like, I totally honed it. I had the best apprenticeship. Mm-hmm. And so what I honed was creating, was destroying. And so that part of what Mary has to bring into that is that what she most avoids is the process of destroying. And so it's like I create victim in her, and she creates persecutor in me, in the middle of that, and we just like both go right into our, you know, like jello game, just like the fun stuff. Like we both, she goes right into her, this is a scary world, I'm gonna retreat, and I go right into fine, you wanna play victim, let's go. You know, and we go, and we polarize, and I think it's just that we've been talking about this, and we're still doing it, we've been talking about it and have a language for it, and I noticed that we're getting, like, we still polarize, but we're getting to here. And we feed a little, and then we're like, okay, this is not going to feed anymore. And we'll just, like, shift it. But, I mean, it's like, we're going, we're very conscious, and then 20 minutes later, it's like, and it's like, I have to really pay attention to it, because it just turns in a moment. And I end up saying, I don't recognize this. I've not seen this one before. You know? And so, I mean, I'll say that to her. I'll say, that's a piece of my crazy self that I've not seen before. So let's look at that one. What did I just do? How did we just do that? And it, I mean, the neatest part is that I have a partner who is doing the work. That's the neatest part. And in the middle of that, that's the hardest part.
Yes.
But when you know, like if you drive through a neighborhood where people aren't involved in becoming conscious of the cycle of the entity coming up, finding a victim, setting up the situation for breakfast, lunch, and dinner, diving in, feeding, you know, orgy time, you know, gorging, and then getting plump, and then sort of backing off and looking at the blood all over the place, you know, smeared dead bodies, and I can go, oh, how did this get here, you know, like, I don't, you know, and then going back to the TV, you know, and just like, and then waiting until you're hungry again, and like, you can just drive down the road and hear, you know, guns going off, people screaming at each other, you know, kids getting beaten, you know, gangs going off on each other, and this whole, it's like this incredible, like, we live in Entityville.
And can you reduce the appetite? I mean, can you, like in Kelly's example, if it took two-thirds of the day to be full, can you reduce that down to half the day and then a fourth of the day and then...
Well, one of the fundamental hypotheses of the non-existence of irresponsibility is that you can have it any way you want it. Do you understand what I'm saying? It's like, so that's just a fundamental hypothesis, is that if, in fact, everything that happens around us, we're creating, we're at source for, if that's true, then we can have it any way we want it, because we can create anything we want. So the question is really, what do you want? In answer to your question, it's like, well, what do you want? You know, and are you willing to pay for it?
Well, how much of feasting and creating dead bodies is a result of not just nurturing my own self and doing what brings me joy? Because basically what I'd set up for myself yesterday was everybody's in the way of my creating my own joy. That was basically my story. And when I got off it...
Mm-hmm. You'll see glad is on both sides of the chart.
Right.
So it sounds like joy or feels like joy, but there's the cost of it is numb. The cost of it is unconscious. So the fact that it cost everybody also that two-thirds of their day to be involved in the whole thing is irrelevant. You were experiencing ecstasy, and everybody else is getting sucked dry, you know, and being killed and vampired, and you know, and that's invisible.
Yeah, but I don't want to do that.
Well, so which I is speaking then? You say, I don't want to do it. Like, which one of the I's? You know, Gremlin is sneaky. Oh, I don't want to do that. You know, Gremlin can say that. You know, and how far can you trust a Gremlin?
You can't. What
was very interesting for me in the event, you know, in looking back, there were several times that I got a picture of myself, like thinking about it now, serving something else. A lot of it was my timing. You know, sometimes what I said, when I said it, you know, how many times I spoke out, you know, it was all about feeding my addiction to attention or approval or whatever. And, you know, since we've been talking here, I've noticed that that's a pattern of my whole life, of what I create when I go into a space, is that I have to gain the attention somehow.
Of who?
Of anybody.
There was an invitation to get a little more clear on your technology.
Yeah.
So it's not of anybody in my experience, but...
You're the person that's in control.
Thank you. See, so if you're willing to confront, if you're willing to study your technology, then you will never answer a question like you did the first time. Anyway, keep going. So you're looking at the purpose of what you create, the result of what you create when you walk into a space. Great, that's the beginning. That's how you...
And I think sometimes I play different roles in order to get that.
Like an actor.
And when I don't get it, then I tell myself a story about it and either leave or I try a new strategy. Or find somebody else in the room that has some kind of something to feed me. And, I mean, manipulation is a huge game.
Are you actually doing it right now?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and my thought of even speaking out was, you know, am I doing it now? I mean, not then, but even before I spoke, I would say, well, if I speak out, am I still doing it? Yes.
And so I want to judge that. I want to judge what those kind of things as good or bad. And there's some kind of, I mean, it's like, okay, I'm hearing stuff today, I'm going to go back and I'm going to look at everything and go, oh God, I'm a killer, I'm awful, I'm bad, I'm evil. Why get up in the morning? And, I mean, how do you do it without judging yourself and just, I mean, okay, is my technology, I use judging myself as a way of being the killer?
I think that I don't know the answer for you, but it is, that's definitely one of the ways that I feed the entity. I spend a lot of time in judgment of myself, and then the variation is to judge others, but the first person that I suck dry is myself, really.
Well, and the philosophical answer to your question, like, have you have an experience of living from a conscious purpose?
I've had experiences where I felt like I created something beautiful and joyful for me and others. Is that what you mean?
Well, I don't know.
Like, I didn't feel like a killer. I felt like I...
If you have experience of living from your conscious purpose and creating consciously, like committing to a principle, knowing you're going to create it, and having it be created. You have that experience?
Yeah.
So, I mean, that's like I said, it's a theoretical answer to your question, but like, if you have an experience of committing to a principle and creating and having it create, then you have the juice, you have the same hit in your body for living from a conscious purpose. And the only reason to get up in the morning is that the possibility exists to create from the conscious purpose and get the same hit of energy. Like, you and I and everyone else I know around me is committed and addicted to the energy that is unconscious purpose. And we have a story saying that's how we fuel ourselves, or that's how we stay safe, or that's how we live, or blah, 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 blah. And so the only reason to get up is that there's another possibility. And that from that possibility, there's infinite probability that things are going to move. My unconscious purpose, my gremlin keeps it the same. It's not about things moving. It's not about development. It's not about growth. It's not about any of those things. It's about keeping it the same, because it's unknown for me and I can play it, you know? This is about really blowing it open. Conscious purpose is about creating this piece and then having it spread. Not even knowing where it's going to go, but the principle is that it's going to go, or that it's, you know, whatever it is, creating a theater, creating a whatever. The principle is going to evolve, and that's the reason to get up in the morning. But that's possible.
And the idea of good or bad is not on the chart. It's not there. The idea of good or bad is just, you know, a judgment of the gremlin, you know, to serve whatever purpose. It's what do you choose to create? The results. What results do you want to choose to create? There's no good or bad about it. If you want to create the results of unconsciously serving the entity to experience, you know, how great it, you know, me to experience being, you know, ecstatically, everything's about me. And if you want to do that, that's what you're creating. It just produces certain results, and there's no good or bad about it.
Well. And can I talk a little bit about us, just mm-hmm. about our, that Baylou and I have known each other and worked really closely together for 7 years. And so we are very similar in many regards. And one of the ways we're similar is that our gremlins are best friends.
Yeah. They like each other.
Yeah. And so what I've noticed with Baylou is that we don't kill each other. Like we do sparring, and like I don't know, we have like Teflon skin, and we like, sometimes we hurt each other, but it's just surface hurt, but because we can really play. And so, but anyone comes near us and we're like a blender and it's like they're just chopped. So what I've been really practicing with Betty Lou is whether or not that can be shifted. And we don't just do that, like that's not just what we do, it's just an entity in our relationship. It's much more than that. But when we start to spar, and that happens, I'm noticing that it's possible to shift it. Like it's possible to, and my example of that would be like when the anger comes up and then my attack comes up, that dynamic I've talked about, and that it provides the fight for you and the fight for me, that I've really said to her, okay, let's undo that. Let's stop. We can fight and spar and there's a payoff for that. Or we can stop that and we can figure out what's under there. What's going on that your fight's coming up, and what's going on for me that mine's coming up? What's really under there? And then we can talk about either what we're committed to or, you know, what we're creating. And inevitably, it's the illusion of safety to not have to face something else that's going on. That's our gremlins are best friends. So it's like, that's been a real teaching tool for me, because it's like, I can do that with her because she's willing to have it shifted. Like I can say, no, we're not going there. And then she may be angry for 30 minutes, but we're not going there. I'm not going to fight it. And she can do it with me, but like we begin to do something other than share gremlin energy. And it's not refined yet. Like, we don't have it down. We're in the middle of it. But it's something other than gremlin energy happening, yeah?
Well, and am I kidding myself to think that my gremlin is smaller, is less powerful than it once was? I mean, or is it what Beth said, that it's just taken a different form? I mean, I don't do the kinds of things I used to do. Almost never. So is that, it's just taken a different form? Or it's not as big as it was?
Who would know the answer to that question?
You.
You are that teacher.
And that was the pint-sized version.
See, if I was interested in taking your center, you know what I mean? If I was interested in feeding off of, like, yeah, I do know the answer. I have the truth. I am the one who knows, and I am the source for your clarity. And like, if I was interested in that, you know, I wouldn't even ask that question. So in answer to part of Judy's question was, like, what I just did then, rather than eating what that little, she offered me a little, what do they call those chocolate covered things?
Those truffle.
Yeah, she offered me a truffle, man. I love truffle. She offers me this truffle, and I could have gone, and the space probably would not have objected to that. So we're talking about integrity. We're talking about impeccability. We're talking about subtle, you know, never putting away the sword of clarity and distinction, this one, you know, conscious or unconscious purpose. What am I serving this moment, this moment, this moment, this moment? Because it's that fast. And once, you know, and then it's like, you know, you put me in a donut store, you know, put me in the same neighborhood as a donut store. And if I'm in the right space, you know, I'm gonna end up with a bag of donuts in my hand and I won't know how it got there. It's like that. That's how subtle this stuff is. So, you know, if you want to try to feed, you know, this entity over here by handing me morsels of truffle, you know, and I choose not to eat that, and I choose to say, well, who could answer that question? You know, then I'm like dieting or something. You know what I mean? I'm preferring the experience of the intensity. I'm preferring the intensity of the experience of not eating to the satiation of having eaten. Like I'm choosing that.
Okay, I didn't get that at first, but because part of your gremlin is to be superior, that's how that fed you. That's how that could have fed you.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Oh, yeah, man. You made one just for me. Awesome. You made a nice one, you know.
Okay.
Almonds
inside. So then it is what Beth said. So it is that the gremlin that was the biggest gremlin for me used to be the one who was committed to revenge. And that gremlin is not so big anymore. The one that I think probably is the biggest for me now is the one that you've described, which is being superior and knowing more than anybody else knows. And I don't do the kind of stuff like you described with Kayla, with the baby. I used to do that, did that to my children. I don't do that anymore, but I do other things. So I was hoping the answer was, no, it's smaller. Yeah, so it had to adapt and take a different form.
I know for me, the victim is a big way that I suck at that. I can play the victim, and I mean, I can keep the story going, you know, and that's how I do it. It's like I get in situations where, you know, I feel like I've been in a situation where I'm a victim again, and I want to talk to somebody about it, and I want to get them to feel sorry for me or give me advice, usually, you know. Like, this is what I need to do. And the ultimate goal is to feel bad about myself. You know, that whatever I talk about, you know, I'm going to end up feeling bad about myself. And then I can blame everybody else, and that's real powerful.
Is that why you were crying before?
I think that was part of it.
Let me ask you that question again, okay?
Okay.
Is that why you were crying before?
No, not necessarily. That was, I feel very much remorse over this whole thing.
Feeling sorry for yourself?
No, I feel remorseful about it.
Okay.
I feel it's been a huge part of my life. Mm-hmm. It's done a lot of damage in my life.
I'm just thinking, as far as the victim, but what I recognize about myself is that I play all three parts in the drama triangle very well, and I have groups that I have played different parts with. Like with that Fred and Beth, I set it up so I can play the victim because I know that I can get something from them, the persecutor. And there are people that I rescue and I'm the hero for, my family specifically. And there are people that I persecute and I go around so I can be better than them and put them down.
Is that chocolate, strawberry, and vanilla?
Yeah. So I get fed all over the map.
Yeah, we kind of set up our map for ourselves as to what we want to eat that day. So our lives are sort of set up that way.
Clint, would you be willing to talk to Cindy about airport transportation, or can I get a message to her?
Yeah.
Call.
Thanks. Hi. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Let's do that. 12:30. Mm-hmm. Just two big bags. Okay, so we have time with Rachel. We have time to go do a little shopping. Thank you. And you'll get the stuff. Can you get the stuff from Kenneth also? Yes. Great. Thank you. Bye-bye. Thank you.
So, so have you not taught us something? Have you not? Because your question was, can you really teach anybody anything? You don't feel like, I feel like you've taught something this morning. Is that not true?
I'm just interested in having conversations like this as a way of bringing a kind of a language or some models that we can use to work with. What I think is that, like, this model has been here quite a bit lately. It's been around, people have heard about it. And it's almost like, what are you going to do with that model? To me, it's like, this is the drama triangle over here, right? And I've seen that model for years, you know, 10 years, 15 years, I've seen this model. But the way that I've taken that model and I've worked with it, I've brought it inside of me. So if I'm the one who's taken this concept or idea and I've brought it inside of me and struggled with it and learned it and identified it and given it names, and it's been, I put effort into it. So somebody couldn't expose the model to me as an idea, but it's really me who took it and has been eating it or working with it and digesting it and hammering with it and like bringing it into me. So I just an interesting question for me, because I'm really interested in facilitating a possibility for clarity and integrity and success and relationship. I'm interested in facilitating the possibility of that. And all I know is that I just for example with Fred, I know that in all our life we've had the opportunity to become more aware of different things, but for some reason Fred has grabbed a couple of things. I know everybody's grabbed different things and using them, but I was just using Fred for example. He just has grabbed a certain thing and struggled with it, you know. And I didn't do that. All I can do, you know, like my role as a, you know, I can just bring this here in a certain way and make it possible for somebody to get friendly with this stuff enough to find the use of it or be interested in it or like that. But I think that each of us, like, you know, Sue came here with a question, and she's like still sitting with that question, and she's got more questions than she had before she got here, and she's going to take these home, and she's going to stand up in front of a group of people who love and respect her, and she's going to probably make a fool of herself in a certain way, or risk making a fool of herself by talking about something that she doesn't even really know about. But she's going to do that as a way of working with it more and starting that conversation in another group of people, because then there's smart people in her company, and they love this stuff too, and they're going to start to talk about this as a new way of being more successful in their, you know, their relationships with each other and the work that they do. So. Like, did Sue teach them something, or did she kind of bring home something? I don't, to share it. Maybe that's what this is more like, sharing. I can share it with you, and then you can use it for whatever you want, something like that. But I really think it's like we each have a responsibility to, it's us who brings it in. It's like you can be exposed to something, but what you do with it is completely up to you.
Well, and I guess then what I'm saying is that I'm then learning from your sharing, which...
The way it looks to me is that I'm sharing, and you're using, you're starting to work with it. Can you say it a different way? It's like, you're learning from the work that you're doing with what's being shared.
The difference is where your center is. Like, that's where I would say the difference is. In traditional teaching models, the center's in the teacher.
Mm-hmm.
And in this teaching model, the center stays in you.
Mm-hmm.
And in that, it creates a level of responsibility because you keep your center.
And you came here on your own. And it's like you got here. I mean, how many other places in Little Rock is this going on? It's like you made your decision to get here.
It is the working example of unconscious and conscious purpose. Clint is being very conscious about what he's creating, and then what I see happening is that it is handed, and then it explodes into possibility, depending on how much you're willing to work it. And so it's like it creates possibility. In the sharing, there's no, you're going to get it, it's going to add up to 100 points, and we're going to be done with it. You know, there's no traditional teaching models at all. It is really how much of the hit you are willing to take. And then you can get more later, or you cannot get more later, or whatever, but it's how much of a hit you're willing to put in your body. I have a question that's, like, I came here to ask you. and something I've been struggling with, and I've talked a bit about it, but it seems to me that in my experience of this, there's a conversation that's sort of like a thin film above this. And it is the conversation of understanding. And traditional teaching models, and I've spoken about this quite a bit, the traditional teaching models reinforce understanding, logic and reason and understanding. Like that's a teaching model, and you filter information through it. And I think it's directly in conflict with this information, because what I'm noticing is that, or at least it's directly in conflict with the way my gremlin works, because understanding is one of the goals. So one of the principles is understanding. And so I catch myself in that filter of understanding, and I immediately know that I'm building a case for something, and that's gremlin. And so in my experience of other gremlins, I haven't ever seen a gremlin who doesn't have that piece. And so what I'm experiencing is that understanding, reason, and logic is part of this conversation, this gremlin conversation. And I'm trying to give a name to the other experience I've had, and the only name that I have for it, the only idea I have for it, is a realm of spirituality. But it's not really spirituality. Like it's a realm of relational. It's a realm of relationship to something other than reason and logic, and it's a relationship to principles that doesn't include reason and logic. And so I don't have a name for that other than the same opening I feel in a spiritual relationship. Like it's the same opening, but this. And for me, I guess it translates the same, because there then is some relationship to God for me in the principles. So it's like it is that same opening. And I haven't known. It's like a feeling in my body, and I can't. What I'm struggling with is making a distinction that's clear enough for me to hold and clear enough to share. And I can't language it yet, and so I'm struggling with the language.
Talk about the experience in your body. Mm-hmm. What's that like?
Of this piece?
Mm-hmm.
So the experience in this, in conscious purpose, is an experience of open. Is an experience of, I don't know, it doesn't feel tied to any. It doesn't feel tied to any commitment other than principle. You know, it doesn't.
But what's the experience of expansion or accomplishment or whatever shift in the conscious model, the conscious side? What's the experience like? So for me, when that I experience that as a shift or getting it, it's like the understanding has a different experience for me than getting it.
Mm-hmm.
Understanding is the mind and the intellect and logic and reason, and getting it is like, aha. It's like, It's like, it's like, it's that sort of a thing rather than, like this and so, and like this and like that, like therefore, and you. And that's like, there's a different experience of the two.
And what comes to me is just that one piece in yesterday's training. I am.
Yeah, that's what I was about to ask.
I mean, it's just, I am that experience there.
Yeah.
That's what comes for me.
And what I heard that was interesting from what you said was that intellect, reason, logic, purpose, you know, gremlin, and then there's principles, and there's, mm-hmm. and this is God. And what I was proposing was like, well, maybe like you're saying this God is only this, is what you were saying. And spirituality happens over here, and that I would, you know, like I don't think there isn't
that right.
Mm-hmm. Are you saying this is the God and this is devil? I mean, are you saying this is right and this is wrong, this is good and this is bad? Well, I heard God only come out over on this side.
Yeah, I don't have it.
That understanding was gremlin stuff, is how you explained it.
Which was excluded from God. I just heard that in your language.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, there was a story about an enlightened, whatever, Muslim guy, Sufi guy, and he went into this temple, and here's the temple with the altar and the everybody's bowing to the altar, and they're all facing towards this, the words, the great words, and the great symbols, and the great, and they're all, everybody's bowing to this, and this Sufi guy is sitting back here, you know, like this, with his feet facing towards the, you know, the symbols of God, and that's strictly forbidden in their formalities, in the, what do you say, the ritual is, excuse me, you do not put your feet, you know, towards the sanctuary of that represents God, and all the leaders of the church, you know, the temple come out, and they're standing around this guy who's supposed to be this enlightened Sufi, and he's sitting here with his feet facing towards, you know, the